Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. We're in the final stretch of episodes for season four, and I thought who else to bring back for a catch-up and a chat is episode 32 guest. It's the hashtag instant classic. I don't know if he's going by that, but I'm going to throw it out there. He's possibly still doing the wrestling. We'll find out during the episode. It's Grant McIvor. Welcome back.
Thank you, buds. Thanks for having us again.
I'm so excited for revisiting yourself as a guest, because when it came to the season two and season one slash season two, I didn't know what I was doing with like research and putting episodes together. Some may say after this point I still don't know what I'm doing, but I think I know better than I did before. So I thought you need to come back on. We need to ask more stuff about random things of your pop culture joys and loves, and you know, maybe some wrestling as well at the same time. We'll just see how we go from there. But the first question, most important one for returning guests, is how's it going?
Quite good. There was a past like year after the COVID break, and everyone was coming back. It was just that sense of everyone's a bit out of shape, and all the world's still very gloom. But I think they feel like the past month, everything's starting to come back into shape now. We had the show, the ICW show at the garage, and I came out of that feeling the best I have about wrestling since way before the first lockdown happened. So it just felt like everything is starting to, not even just in the sense of feeling happy but doing wrestling again, and constantly going back and through and doing it all, everything. I just felt like this is a peak that I've reached, because I genuinely felt that was one of my favourite shows, and I was very much happy to kind of get back to that level of not even just performance but just enjoyment of it. Because it was very much one, the main reason everybody got into wrestling is because they enjoy wrestling. So you get through the slump, so just like as soon as it becomes that thing that you're just making sure you do, sometimes that kind of love wanes, and it's just you're just going through the motions. But it was very good to be out of that aspect of I'm just doing this because I said a few years ago that would do it, and now it's like I'm back to enjoying it. I'm back enjoying training, I'm back enjoying working on shows. Every aspect of it is enjoyable again.
Excellent. Yeah, it's been a long road, because last time we spoke, even though the episode went out in February 2021, it was like November 2020 because of my absolute abysmal management skills for episodes. So like you were saying just off the recording, when we started speaking, Joe Biden was not in office. When the episode went out, he'd already had his first 30 days. And yeah. I was really annoyed about when I put it out, because I was like, oh my God, we just spoke about, oh, you've just started making more appearances in ICW. You've just started doing closed door shows. And at this point, you've had matches near every week on the network.
Yeah.
Going, how do you think it's going to go? So yeah, we'll go back there. So November 2020 is where we last left off in our timeline of Grant McIvor. And the manifesto was just kind of forming, or just coming together in some ways or fashion. And now it's one of the big villain factions in ICW. So how have you found getting into that side of Grant McIvor and tapping into it? We'll go from the closed door shows and then metamorphosing it into the crowds. How did you find it translated?
It was good. Also, like, there's one thing about like trying something new in front of no crowd is there's no immediate feedback. I think I kind of said that back in like November, the closed door shows, where it was fun to kind of have a bit of free creativity because you're not listening to a crowd and thinking, oh, they're not enjoying this, we need to do something to change it. But at the same time, you are doing entirely new gimmick, an entirely new kind of style of even wrestling character, and you've got no immediate feedback from a crowd, and thinking that are the people at home watching this enjoying it? What do they think? You don't get that until the crowd comes in front of you again. So I think the first crowd show we had again was August, and you could see that we're starting to take, because there was ones that they recognised the gimmick, they recognised the characters, and they recognised that they had established feelings about the group, which was good. So it was just one of those ones where, which I think, you don't know until you get that immediate feedback. So I think we had some growing pains back when we were establishing everything. It was just like, okay, where is the kind of direction that we actually want to go? Because we've got three different people following one idea, or four different people following one idea, and it's just, okay, how do we marry up? Because I knew some folk inside the group. I also know ADM for years, Eddie Castle, kind of known him in passing, and then it was very much my first time meeting Dylan Thorne. So we're just sense of these three different wrestlers, four different wrestlers that are trying to make a name for themselves, and we're just following this new way of direction, and we're just trying to kind of make sure, how do we get into that groove, and then as soon as we get there, how do we shoot to them in, essentially, with it.
How did you find it when you got back in front of the crowds? Because of course you had been in front of crowds before in ICW as part of Power Forward, and then I don't know if that was ever revealed.
Yes, it was.
Thank God. Right. Okay. I just didn't want to go. You were Power Forward. As part of Power Forward, and of course as yourself as well. Do you find there's a bit of a change? I suppose it's going from the garage to the asylum as well. How did you find the change in crowd?
Yeah, with ICW, there's always that. It's almost an intimidating atmosphere. Essentially, you felt it a lot more with the garage shows, that the folk are there, they're getting drunk, they've got that, it's that whole Glasgow performance anxiety. You always hear that of comedians going, Glasgow is a comedian's graveyard because they're not afraid to tell you what they feel like. And it's like ICW is over 18s, it's folk drinking, it's adults. They're not just there to go, oh, clappy clappy, because we're here at a show. It's like they have a standard. Mm-hmm. They have a standard of what wrestling, what you see, what kind of performance they want to see, what kind of entertainment they want to see. So you always felt that. Coming back to the asylum, it was a bit different. Also, they had that kind of sense of everyone still wearing masks when they're coming to see the show. So there's not, and you get that kind of muffled kind of cheering. It's a smaller venue, which is one of the ones, it was a smaller venue and we had a smaller crowd to start off with, but it was just one was like, you're happy to get that crowd back in, you're happy to get ICW fan regulars back in, because their support's been constant throughout this entire period. They've still been coming out, they've still been queuing up outside the asylum waiting to get in. They still want to have that buzz when they're going to an ICW show, and they're still determined to maintain that, because that's one of the most important parts of a wrestling show, is making sure the fans want to be able to come to the show. And I'm very much happy to see that the general crowd that are always there are still always there. They're always turning up, and that's a very good aspect of it.
It's always overwhelming, of course, having people in front of you again, being able to show you if you're doing the right thing with the whole your character direction from that point, which is always good. I was like in back in front of a source crowd then, so that's why your home promotions. I've just written down the date you unfortunately lost the source championship, but was there a source show before then as well? Did you get a defense in before?
Yes.
Date in front of me. See, professionalism is still quite low in the list of things on this podcast. As long as it goes out, that's kind of, and we don't say anything too controversial. There we go. Hang on, right. Returns, of course, December. That makes sense. So you defended against Darren J. Blair. You defended against in the first return show of Source Wrestling in December. So what was it like for getting in front of your home crowd once again?
It was a lot, quite good. It's essentially, obviously, that's a lot of families kind of shows. Those shows, and especially with the younger trainees that are just starting out, you're more likely to get a ton out from their friends and family, even the ones that are just, they're not much interested in wrestling, but they're a lot interested in seeing their pal come out. So Dan had a big, very big turn out for him, especially since they knew he was fighting for the title. And then one of the ones like, oh, you never know, you might win it. But it was still the same amount of people that kind of come to see a Source show. And you've got your like your friends that you constantly train with and work with that are in the crowd as well, and they're actually getting to see you, they're obviously get able to give you the immediate feedback as well, because you're still like people you work with and your people you're constantly training with, you still value their opinion and seeing that like you've actually shine a good way, you're shining now. How good you, how well you've came along. There's obviously they're being honest with some bits, like oh, I didn't really enjoy that kind of part. As long as like just need to take that honestly as well. But it was very much a very good experience coming back to a social. And I wanted to have I was very happy to have a good match with them. I think when I was champion, I wanted to be able to kind of wrestle a lot of the younger guys that were essentially coming out. Like I eventually got to a point where I'm getting on a lot more shows. I'm breaking through into ICW that I don't want to, like, be. I'm not essentially going to be constantly training a lot. I joined Source in 2013, and then I debuted in 2016. So essentially, I'm a graduate now. I've kind of passed going to the school every week to go to a class and try and like harness. I can go there every now and again to just go, oh, I want to kind of work on this and you kind of sharpen this part. But I wanted to give something to like the new crop that was coming out. I wanted to face a lot more while I was champion. But obviously, I'm not the person that books the shows. Mm-hmm. But I'm very much happy that I got to at least have one with, say, Dern. And Dern's been, without putting the rest down, he's very much been put as a star child from that group that's came out. So, and he's getting himself a lot more work. He's got himself in Reckless. I think he's getting himself up into KFNS as well shortly. So there's a lot of people that have taken recognition to him. Hopefully he gets himself into ICW sooner rather than later. But he's starting to shape himself up to be a really good wrestler.
Yeah, I think when I was speaking to Robbie Wishart for one of the Source preview shows, I think it was for Resurgence, we'd chat to him about it. And he was just seemed to put a lot of stock in Darren J. Blair. Of course, that was his last match in Source as well. So it's maybe in part trying to sell a show, but also there was very much an honesty there going, no, this is a guy that we're going to put a lot of power behind, because he's worked hard enough to earn that push. I suppose that's the word.
Just one of those ones that are just naturally quite good. As I was not too sure, I think it's like 19, maybe coming up to 20 now, but he's been there since he was a teenager. I started when I was 21, so I very much was already an adult when I came there, and nothing came natural to me. It was one of the ones that I had to constantly top train, constantly work hard for it. I'm not saying that he hasn't, that almost comes across quite poorly, but I think he has just one of those guys that just look at it and it's like, everything just comes to you naturally, and you're just like, I hate you for it. But you obviously don't know how much hard work goes behind the scenes. I know he is somebody that puts his work in and he puts his effort in, but it's like, it's very much as somebody compared to, say, me, because I came up with a crop that just had, no, you're absolutely golden. And I was like, well, there's just a group of people that just don't get it and they take too long to get it. And unfortunately, I fell into that category. But fortunately, he's a guy that falls into the category of he just gets it. So hopefully there's a lot more good stuff to come in.
It's always scary seeing these folk, late teens, that are just ridiculous in the ring. And I mean, for yourself, you've been wrestling from training onwards for what, coming up to 9 years, something like that now. So you've been in the ring, but from my side of things, at 31, looking at these like 19-year-olds, and I'm looking at them going, that is disgusting.
I think it's a 16-year-old boy that signed with AEW. He was like wrestling on maybe good wrestling or another promotion in America, and folk are just showing his stuff, and it's just like, how dare you be that good so young?
And the scary thing out of all that is you see a 16-year-old, but there's probably a 9-year-old in Japan, a 9-year-old girl in Japan that can do all that but better. I only wish I kind of tried a little bit that 1 week when I was in high school where I had a six pack and then decided to.
It'll be the same in every sport. There'll be a guy who's 32 playing with Elgin City and some 17-year-old loanee from Manchester comes in and just outshines him, and it's like, I've been working as a professional for over 10 years and this boy's better than me already. And you're like, so it's just, it's a natural ability sometimes with folk. And
absolutely. I think if you get bitter about it, then that's probably the wrong path. Yeah. You just have to go, yeah, you're good as well.
Yeah. It's one of those, like, if you look at somebody and you're like, you're at that good at this age, if you don't become a superstar, then it's essentially your own fault. So it's one of those, like, if you see a lot with coaches, if they see a guy with potential, they're constantly pushing, they're constantly trying to make sure that they're getting the opportunities and they're getting the chance because they can see something in them and they want them to do well. There's always that kind of sense of, I want you to have what I never had. So it's always,
yeah.
And that's a sense of a good, you know, a good coach, a good promoter, because a good promoter will know somebody's worth money and they want to put them on shows. So it's every aspect of wrestling is making sure you're worth that money. That's it.
So coming back to Source though, so you've done a couple months, a couple shows at ICW, new character, absolute, obviously, and also a different kind of just persona in the ring as well. Your moveset was a bit more rough and ready, determined, yeah. Rougher. I've used rough twice there, but you know, it means it's doubly as rough. You're conscious of that some people in the crowd at Source, of course, there'll be the friends and families and what have you, but there might be some that have seen, oh, I see that Grant McIvor guy on the network. I better go see him. I see him live. I better go. Were you conscious of trying to add some of that manifesto-ness into that match, or were you more a case of, no, this is my friends and family persona, the Gazelle, the Source champion, Grant McIvor, and that on the guy on the telly is the manifesto?
There's some aspects that are going to kind of transfer over, especially if I'm still playing the villain aspect and everything. Like, the ICW character is a complete different entity from the still doing the wrestling character, which gets you as everybody else. The ICW, the manifesto character is exclusive to ICW, whereas the still doing the wrestling character is like, still with that kind of, I have a wee kind of smarkiness and mockiness and confidence about it, but then when it gets to that point of, I want to batter the hell out of this guy, we turn it up a wee bit. So there's some aggression come out. It's not as violent, as I would say, but it's still one of those ones like the crowd will go, I do not like him to an extent. It's almost like if you're very much familiar with Dennis Reynolds and Always Sunny,
right?
There's a kind of switch of just, okay, I'm getting a bit annoyed. I'm getting a bit annoyed now. So that you can see that he tries to keep that kind of, no, I'm very nice, I'm the cool guy, and then that just, it's that kind of snap, like a half-wee psychotic bit, that kind of creeps out. But with Manifesto, it's almost very much, no, I always want to hurt you. Right. Whereas, so anywhere else, it's very much still professional wrestler who will just maybe do what he needs to do to get a win. That's
I probably said in our last chat that I still haven't gotten into Always Sunny. I tried really hard with the TV show, but for some reason I love the podcast. I don't know why. It seems like I like the characters talking about how awful their real life. Well, they're not the real life talking about how their characters are awful. Yeah. But watching it just gives me the just absolute, I hate all of you, and I know I'm supposed to, but there's no redeemable qualities about you guys that I can. That I need to have to watch a TV show, but no, the Dennis Reynolds. Every time I hear a TikTok or a GIF or that, I'm just like, I want to love the show because everything I see of it, it's hilarious. But together, I can't do it. I just can't get through it.
It's one of those kind of, like, I always associate that with Malcolm in the Middle when I was a kid. It's like it's meant to be cringy, and you're meant to kind of be awkward. But it was one of the ones like I can't watch it that much. There's a lot of you try binge watching, you're just like, I need something with a happy ending because, like, Always Sunny, I think Malcolm in the Middle are always the same, that there's no happy ending. There's no, like, happy ending for the characters. They always, like, always get what's coming to them because a lot of them aren't nice. Malcolm in the Middle, there's some redeeming qualities to the characters, but they're all very mean-spirited. So it's always, like, kind of like, oh, life is unfair, like Malcolm in the Middle says. But yes, always Sunny, get it watched. Like, even if you can push yourself through season one, and even just watch an episode at a time. I know people that have like watched it, binge watch it, and watched it multiple times over.
Oh, I mean, I got up to the Nightman, and that was kind of where I went, right, this is supposed to be the best episode, and I watched it, like, I liked it, but it's not keeping me going with it. But I get that I think the Office US kind of maxed out my cringe meter when it came to it, because it was so cringy watching it, and I thought, okay, but there's still some characters I like, but no, always Sunny. I was like, nope, none of yous. Dennis, stalled him. I like Charlie as well. He's just an absolute unhinged lunatic, but no, altogether, can't do it. I've tried. I was like, don't know how we end up on there. You mentioned Always Sunny, that was it. That's how we ended up in the pop culture tangent already quite early on. As well as, I mean, shows have started up again. They're thankfully now coming a bit more regularly. Obviously, there's every weekend, there's at least two or three shows. But how are you finding, kind of, you're talking about getting back into wrestling, now you're at a point where you enjoy it again, but how is that easing back into traveling and going back and seeing all these people and seeing faces, some you want to see, some in the crowd that you don't want to see? What was it like getting back in the swing of things? Be doing the wrestling.
It was good. Like, I think a very big part of when it was just very restricted, which I was still not seeing a lot of people. There's the social aspect of it all. You still want to see those people that you get along with, and people you really don't see unless you're actually at a wrestling show sometimes, because you don't have that level of a social relationship. But you still have that kind of stuff. Oh, you're very much happy to see them at a wrestling show. Which is good. Traveling wise, I'm still very much based in Glasgow. The only places I'm kind of working regularly with just now are, say, ICW Source, Girders, which is started up this year. And be going out to Pro 2 quite soon. But I think that's going to be my first time in Ayrshire properly. But, and that's one as well, where can I get myself out a bit more along different areas? I don't just want to be Glasgow based. Maybe we make sure I get myself out in different places, but it's very good to kind of just get back and like block locker room chat. It's very underrated. You just get like talk nonsense with all your pals or wrestlers, like just stuff you wouldn't be able to do like beforehand. It's very good.
It was a bit of an advantage with the whole manifesto stuff is you had a friend in like ADM as well, someone like for a long time. So at least there's some of that social aspect straight away, even though you're starting to, you knew Eddie, but getting to know Dylan, it was a little bit of a social interaction. And I suppose being in a faction as well also helps, because that means your group's a little bit bigger. When you were doing the closed doors, you might have only, if you're doing a singles match, you saw two people maybe, the person you're against and the referee. That was about it.
So that was it. Back then, it was just, I think, there was four people booked. Basically, round robin, you face him in the first match, and then you face the other guy in the second match. And you switch about, you get a break, you see the referee, and that's it. And now it's just, the locker room's full again. Everyone's like, you've got a full show again. That's it. It's running back to how it used to be, which is good.
So, absolutely not involved with your actual wrestling. What was it like watching Raw Rumble in 2021? When 2021? Yes. When a certain Edge was at number one. And then towards the end, I think one of your favorite wrestlers of all time, Christian, made his in-ring return. What was your reaction? Were you watching it live?
Yes, I was watching it live. It was very much that kind of scream. Just straight away, because you didn't recognize the initial part of the song. I think I also put my reaction on Instagram as well, which is just me reenacting the big lookout. And it was one of those, like, pretty much happened. I was like, he's back. And then I just went, is he thinking about bringing back the entrance suit? Like, because it was one of those, like, I went and tweeted him. I went up, it was like, as soon as the thing went out, the network tweeted all about the Christian Cage inspired wrestling jacket, he liked it, and I don't know if that was what caused him to come back. I'm not saying it isn't. Like, you've seen somebody else wrestling with that big entrance suit on, but I'm just, I was very much happy he's back. I'm happy to see that he's went and done stuff in AEW as well, only won the Impact title again. So just bringing back that big era of Christian Cage. He was always a big name player in WWE, but then he kind of went to Impact and became his own. Like, he showed himself as this top singles wrestler, which is good. That was the first. I think that was the very first time I actually heard of Impact, because some guys in school were talking about Christian Cage. I'm just like, who's the hell is Christian Cage? Oh, it's just Christian from WWE. He's called Christian Cage in TNA now. And he's like, he's the best wrestler there. I'm like, really? Because all my stock was in Edge, mm-hmm. essentially, because I still love that tag team, but was Edge was face for or good guy very much for the big time, and then just the cool as hell heel, and then find a big Christian Cage. I was like, yep, I'm sold on you now.
So I mean, obviously you are excited to see him in Impact and all that kind of stuff, but you mentioned the jumpsuit. So is it also, is there like maybe 10% in the back of your mind going, please don't come out in that, please don't come out in that? And if he does, you go, well, mine's going in the bin then. That's it over.
No. Then I get the birthday parties as Christian Cage.
Ah,
it's me. It's Elsa from Frozen, Moana, and then me. It's Christian Cage.
I'd imagine you've got like just a row of Christian inspired gear. You got the tights with the, instead of the C, it's a G instead.
That's the initial part of the manifesto run was the fishnet vest as well.
Of course, it's a bold look. Not many people can pull off a fishnet vest. I think that's pretty much all I can say about that. But it's definitely, I couldn't do it. I'd look like ham.
I very much try to be very androgynous. The androgynous sex symbol of the manifesto. Still working on it.
I mean, it's for handsome lads. It's going to take a special
very
effort.
Sexy, very evil.
There you go, Danhausen, eat your heart out. So as soon as Christian came back, you were actually one of the first people who came to mind, because I knew, of course, that was your big love of Christian. I don't think we talked a lot about Impact, and so Christian was your introduction to Impact, or TNA at the time, I suppose. What was that, 2005, something like that?
2005, 2006, I say. Like, I think didn't watch too much of it. Like, I think that kind of period of time I'd still fell out of wrestling, but it was one of the ones that was on Challenge, so it was very much free to watch. I think everything else was on, I was in Sky Sports, maybe in Sky One if you were up early enough on a Saturday morning, but it was just a wee check out. So it was very much that sense of finding out, oh, there's more wrestling now. Mm-hmm. But I knew about WCW and ECW, and then obviously I knew that went into WWE. But it was good to see that, oh, it's different variety of wrestling as well. It's like WWE, it wasn't just the main place anymore. It was very much still the top dog when it comes to wrestling. Mm-hmm. In a sense, I kind of view it as the McDonald's of wrestling.
Easy to watch,
easy to digest, and it's always there. And I probably will never be beaten. But it was good to know that, oh, there's a different place. So that if you were getting, there's a place with different characters, same thing, wrestling, but a place with different characters, a place with different stories, a place with different styles of matches, which a lot of people, it's one thing that kind of annoyed me over the past maybe like 10 years with a lot of, you know, wrestling fans online just all waiting for the death of TNA or the death of Impact. I'm just like, it's a different place to watch wrestling, it's a different place for guys to work, which has always been a good thing. So I never understood that kind of hate. That was like, well, those points were just folk kind of just didn't like for the storylines that were coming out of there. But we'd also complain about WWE as well, which is just, since you can never make a lot of fans. You can make some of the fans happy. Some of the time you can't make all the fans happy all the time.
The internet is just a place of gatekeeping. I think that's probably the best way to put it. Because it's no, you're not allowed to like what you like. That's pretty much the be all and end all, especially Twitter. Thankfully, I don't follow. I keep seeing loads of like people going, "Oh, nobody's ever happy." It's like, my timeline's fairly positive. I'm quite happy with that, because as either wrestlers that I follow, so they don't want to say anything bad about in our promotion because that's an opportunity, you know, right or wrongly, it's an opportunity. So I don't want to go, oh, WWE, absolute shit. I don't want to, I think they're the worst thing in the world. And then they'll phone you up and go, oh, do you want to work for us? Oh, how do we look through your chair? Never mind.
Yeah.
Put the phone down.
I've heard that story a few times. But that was Impact was just a very good, like, it was that kind of place that kind of showed me, oh, there's more to the wrestling world. I learn, then you learn of Ring of Honor, then you learn of New Japan, because I was still a kid and the only thing that was accessible to me was WWE. Mm-hmm. So it was a good point to kind of learn all those different places and those different people, and a lot of those different guys obviously went on to work in WWE. And you get exposed, and the good, a good aspect of Impact as well was that you had WWE guys going over to work there. It was like once their kind of, say their time came up in WWE, they went over. Like, so you had Kurt Angle, you had Nash, just like guys that are still going, like, I can still go, I can still work. So it was like you had that recognizable face as you learn well of new characters as well. Because it's a weird thing as well. It's weird to think back to the very first time I watched WWE and I had no clue who everybody was. And it's just that kind of point of you fall in love with it instantly and you're trying to learn about everything all at once, which is, you don't have the kind of childish enthusiasm to do such anymore. And it's just very much like that kind of recognizable face. So it was like Christian was a good part of that, and then so was Kurt Angle. And I kind of started to watch it sporadically until maybe about 2010, 2011 when I full on got into wrestling. Mm-hmm. And I was just trying to watch everything as much as I could before I actually started training.
Oh, that's it. I mean, I suppose back in ye day, 2005, I don't think fast internet was a thing. So if you wanted to find out more about some of the stuff, if you went on YouTube, you had to do it after 6 o'clock because that's when it was free. After you did the old dial-up tone. I don't know, I could be aging myself. It could have been broadband at that point, but you had to work to find all these things out about wrestling and find out all about the roster. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you're right. I loved when it was TNA Impact. I catch little bits here and there, and there's some favorites. I'm like, I need to find out more about them. Jordynne Grace being one. As soon as I saw her in Impact, I was like, I see her do more wrestling because she's amazing. So I went and found something on, I can't remember what the promotion was. I want to say Black Label Pro, possibly. That sounds like a promotion. Some of her matches there, she had a match with Orange Cassidy, and it's like, this is a whole new world. I don't have the time to delve into this now as a grown-up, but at least I know it's there to pick up on. Right, back into your journey. That was the first of many tangents of the next wee well. So we've got March 2022. So Iron Girders, is that where you're kind of basing your training now, as well as the visits to Source?
Yeah, it's like Girders a very good place. Like it was during the kind of closed doors place tapings of ICW where, like, we were given, like, a few people were training there, but basically given that place to kind of to organise our matches and, like, everything, let's just say match prep, because of essentially it was some of the times, like, you're just showing up and then instantly having to do whatever match you're doing. So we were given a good bit of prep time. So from that, we were given a Girders membership, which is just like it's a gym to use, and it's kind of almost essentially exclusive to wrestlers, I think, which is good because you're going in there and you're actually meeting some other wrestlers while they're training. You're asking them what you kind of working on, and you kind of get feedback from them. You kind of work with them. You kind of learn from them as well what their goals are and what they're trained towards, which is good. So same as well. It's like Girders is a good place to kind of get my reps in as well. It's like if you're able, you kind of just go in. Like Source was very much you have to book in a class and you have to do whatever the class schedule's doing. Girders is very good in the sense that if you're a member, you can go up, book the ring for a certain time, and then do whatever it is you want. You can do, like, if you want to work in your drills, you want to work in your footwork, you want to get somebody in, you want to kind of go run through sequences, whatever. like bit of a to improve on yourself. It's a lot more kind of freedom for someone who's like training wrestling, in the sense of like, you've got if you just want to kind of train with a group and you want to get in, you want to get those reps in. But if you just if you're a lot more established and you don't have the time to go to a certain time class, mm-hmm. you can just jump in whenever you can find time available, which is a lot more better if you're stuck for time like that.
Was the advantage as well? I was gonna say it's an advantage of it. It's a rest. It's well, it's Wolfgang or it's part of it that's set up Aaron Girders. So it's better that it's a wrestler led gym, because he'll know, or his team or whatever, they'll know what the best equipment is to do certain things in the ring. Because it's again a personal trainer and doing the gym, I assume. Saying all this as a very chubby man, but I'm assuming that they'll just work at you to either look or feel the best way you want to or want to look. But at least Aaron Girders, they're going, right, you can look like that, excellent, we'll help you to do that, but if you want to be a bit more more stamina in the ring, you should try this or do that kind of thing. So it's a bit more, it's wrestler focused, I suppose, is where I'm trying to go from that.
Basically, like, you've got I always said wrestling's like a variety show, and you've also got a different variety of wrestlers of like what they want to do. Do you want to look like a bodybuilder? Do you want to be high flying? Do you want to be a big power mover? There's all different kind of styles, and you obviously need different types of training for those styles. So like if you think of it, a wrestling match as say like a football team, the same type of training that a goalkeeper will go through is not the same type that a winger will go through, and vice versa of a defender. So there's always different kind of positions. Like Rey Mysterio will not do the same workout as Batista,
right?
Just like Batista won't do the same workout as that Yokozuna. There's always that different, and then Yokozuna won't do the same workout as the Bella Twins. There's always that kind of difference of training for that kind of whatever style of wrestler you are. Best way I can think of it is like if you think of SmackDown vs. Raw 2008, we had every wrestler had two different styles. So you're a brawler, you're a high flyer, you're a technician. So whatever you need to work on, there's a bit more direction, and you have that kind of more creativity. In the sense of like, okay, I want to work on this. Whereas if you just go to a kind of a training class, there's almost that kind of one direction, because like you almost get that kind of sense that sometimes our coach is like, this is how I wrestle, I'm implementing that onto you. And so that's absolutely not a bad way to kind of start off, especially. But essentially when you're getting in and you're getting your reps in, you're back on shows and you want to create that identity, you need to be where you kind of go, okay, I'm going to go this way. And if you've got more, a bit more of a personal interaction, you're able to go that way a bit more.
I've now all I've got in my head is Yokozuna doing the Bell Twins entrance. So if anyone wants I haven't got the DLC for 2K22. So if anyone wants to create that and send me it, that's I won't tell you what I do with the footage. I'm just saying that I would appreciate it. God, I've now all got in my head. That's terrible. Right. So anyway, Aaron Girders started, they decided to start running shows then, and you were on the Aaron Girders shows, and you ended up, you know, just going into wrestling Saqib Ali and walking out with the Scottish Interpromotional Championship. How was that? What was it like going and getting into the ring at Aaron Girders, a place you trained, getting in the ring with Saqib Ali, and then coming out with a title belt to boot?
It was good finally breaking into the multiverse of wrestling. I was very, very happy with that. So it was just Girders has obviously just started out, but it's already got a good family wrestling show atmosphere. You do feel that it's one of the very first kind of campy wrestling shows as we get on. They just have like a big crowd there that's just very much buzzing for wrestling. I feel like so it's very much I felt like a Gladiators show. Ah, just like, right. that big kind of crowd for it. It was a bit different of like different aspect of how everything's structured out, but absolutely loved every second of it because it was just a very happy show. Like there was no kind of like, oh, I'm very worried about this kind of part of the show, this part of the match. It's like you just went out to want to go out there and have a fun match. So it's like Saqib is very much a good comedy wrestler, a different style wrestler, and I always try to kind of be a bit more of a kind of switchblade, a Swiss Army knife when it comes to wrestling. Whereas I can go and work with a guy who's doing a different style and on one week and a different style the other week. So but that was very much one of like my favourite kind of comedy matches to kind of do, which was good. And I was very happy that I was able to kind of go and win a championship as well. It was like, it's never underrated to win a championship. And it was Pro 2 that was actually the promotion that had the championship on the line because they're very much interpromotional and you wanted to get over that aspect of this title can change anywhere when it's defended anywhere. I think that was the first time it was lost outside of Pro 2 anyway.
It was won
outside of Pro 2, which very much happy to be the first person to win the interpromotional championship at a different promotion. So it was good to have a bit of fun with that as well as where am I going? I've got all these different promotions wanting the new interpromotional champion, and then unfortunately lost the first defence, which was a bit of a downer, but had to cancel a few bookings after that.
Cameron Thompson, of course, Kid Thompson.
I was going to Largs.
The dream. The Largs dream is over. Cameron Thompson, Kid Thompson of Pro 2 did ask, how did it feel to win the Scottish Promotional Championship? We've answered that. I've already asked the question, so we've kind of got that in there. But yeah, it's an interesting concept of a championship, like you said, the multiverse of wrestling, where you can pick up this belt and then that's it. Your next couple matches that have already been pre-booked, well, suddenly they've got a belt on the line. They've got or in your case, unfortunately, you could book the champion and then you lose it in the first defense, and then the next match you've got is a bit awkward when you're supposed to be coming out with the title.
I've not got it, mate. I've lost it.
It was weird, though, because that happened.
It's a gamble you take. It's the gamble you take.
It was such a weird thing, though, because of course, I do the match announcements and stuff like that. And then when you won the title off Saqib, I think Respect announced us another match the next night for the show, and they'd already had Saqib defending. So I was like, do I edit this to take out? Because Saqib doesn't have the belt. And then by the time the show came around, he'd won it back. Yeah. So it was like, it was a moot point by that point. It was a cow's opinion. So I didn't need to worry about it. But it was like, I don't know what to do. This multiverse thing actually messes with my brain with the whole trying to keep a log of the wrestling.
I really like it, though, as well. It's a fun concept. And it's essentially like it gets a lot of promotions working with each other, which is good. It's like it gets a bit more kind of like the Scottish wrestling community is a bit more happy with each other and they'll be able to work with each other, which is good.
Always a good thing. I like a harmonious.
Yeah.
I mean, as much as you know, I'm not against finding out all the goss and finding out all the backstage scuffle. I'd rather just everyone get along, because even though it's boring, it's nice. It's just a nice calming place. And it just keeps everyone ticking. But we're not a gossip site, so I won't ask for any goss too much unless you want to reveal. So we've got Ryan Griffin asking a quick question. I should have really started off with this one. He just asked, are you still doing the wrestling?
Yes, I'm still doing the wrestling. Yes, Uncle Ryan. Yes, Uncle Ryan, I'm still doing the wrestling.
How's the... Good business. How's t-shirt sales going? But that's a blunt question. But how's have you thought of more designs to incorporate the still doing the wrestling motif?
I had an idea, but it's one of the ones. I still want to kind of ship whatever I have left. Those that I did when I put out that batch. It was like initially just like kind of pre-orders, like I'll just see what the interest is and I'll sell what comes in order, and then I was just like, I'll order a few extras just in case, because I just want the ones that kind of just try put them on shows. I'm still wearing them, I'm still kind of like, you have a lot of people that like still love the gimmick, so just maybe ones like that, maybe they'll take the shot. But that's the whole the carny part of wrestling. It's like buy my merch, please, all that kind of stuff. But that's okay. If I was to do another t-shirt, maybe it would just be like pre-orders, like who's interested, and then that's it. But obviously there's a lot more wrestlers going about, so it's very much like I only want to buy a t-shirt that one I like the design of, and two I like the wrestler of. So but I still like it, it's still one of my favorite shirts, and I sold a lot more of that than I did my first shirt anyway, which is good. So
I realized I could have actually worn, because I've got both of them. I could have actually worn it for the episode and wee free plug for you. But the red one, still doing the wrestle one. It gets when I do wear it about the town, you know, the fancy soirees that I attend. That it does get quite a few looks, and there we go. For the audio listeners, you have to watch the video. So it does get a few looks, and I've even had one or two people ask me where to get one. So it's just, yeah, like I say, it's that carny nature, which I think I've grown to love in wrestling. Just when you see things like, we're back to Impact, it's like when something big happens in WWE or even AEW, Samoa Joe debuts, and then Impact the next day put up like a Samoa Joe match.
Yeah.
I love that sort of just give me the hits.
Tongue in cheek. Yeah.
It's the best thing.
You get like football is like, I think tomorrow night you have probably a former Celtic player playing in the Champions League final, and then Celtic will just post something and say, oh, congratulations to a guy who played with us 8 years ago and has played for two other clubs since then. just to get themselves a wee couple of hits. That's it.
I do it every so often when I know someone who won't think I'm a bit of a dick about it. When if it's their birthday, I'll go, happy birthday. Why not check out our interview with them in this link here? I've done it a few times. Like, only one person has called out me, and that is pretty carny. And I'm like, got me some hits, I don't care. And
Moxie Malone doing a promo for our upcoming match at Girders wearing my shirt, and I'll just cheekily going in the comments. That's the link, by the way.
Speaking of them, Moxie Malone, well, excellent segue. Not spelt the way that I thought it would be. We've got the IGWP, which is a bit of a mouthful, championship tournament coming up, which is, I think it's starting this weekend as of recording, so it would have already started.
Yes, it starts tomorrow, as of recording, it starts tomorrow, May 28th.
You're in group D.
Yeah.
It's doing the bit of an old school football tournament ish
kind
of thing. You're in a tournament bracket with Leighton Buzzard and Moxie Malone. So when you saw the concept of the IGWP, hopefully there's a different. Wait, it is Aaron Gerrard's Wrestling Pro?
Yeah.
Or is it IGPW? Oh, I don't care. Anyway, so it's not a championship though. It's an opportunity. What do you think of the round robin concept? I know you're a bit of a culture buff and this kind of World Cup style knockout thing. What were your thoughts on the whole kind of concept of this tournament?
I like it. It's obviously it's a different kind of concept, but there's a lot more opportunities for matches. There's a lot more opportunities for people to get on shows, which is good. And there's a lot more kind of matches, obviously, for wrestling fans to see. Obviously, you get the traditional, but if you look at and see putting 16 wrestlers in, then there's a certain number of matches. I'm very happy this has got that kind of concept of there's a rivalry with inside that group of who wants to be number one. So I think this weekend is my bye week. I will not be wrestling because there's groups of three. Only one match of a group will be happening at a time. So it'll be three shows coming up. I am on the June show and the July show, where I'll be fighting Leighton Buzzard and Moxie Lawn, respectively. They are fighting each other this week. It's my bye week. I can put my feet up. I'll be looking and see who comes out on top, whether it be Leighton, whether it be Moxie. And then after that, just see who of our, which one of us ends up on top until we go into the semi-final bracket. I think it's semi-final or if it's a fatal four-way, but either or, I'm looking forward to it. It's a different concept, it's a different, and it gives a bit more drama, I'd say, to an extent. So say if Leighton beats Moxie, and then Leighton beat Moxie, then Moxie beats me, then we've got a match where it could determine whether Leighton goes through in 2 points, or if every single one of us ties on 1 point, and then it has to go to a tiebreaker. So there's a lot more drama, and there's a lot more stuff that could happen from it, instead of just as decisive, you win, you go through forward. So
I really like that it's just that since the restart of wrestling, it seems that there's no defined men or women's divisions now. I mean, of course, there's still women's centric titles, but pretty much everything else is open season from that point onwards. We saw like Molly Spartan and Casey winning the TNT tag titles down in England. Yeah. And then, of course, this tournament has got the likes of, we've got Moxie Malone, we've got Molly, we've got Casey, we've got Ellie Armstrong. We've got a bunch of names. Angel Hayes, I think, in the tournament brackets.
Yep. We've also got the big gauntlet as well, which has a number of women wrestlers as well that'll be taking their shot at it, which is good.
It's just becoming wrestling. There's no divisions of gender anymore, which is ace. Especially when you likes of just the Disco Derby. I think have you been announced for the Disco Derby?
I've not, unfortunately.
No.
It's been a while since I've been in disco, but I'd love to go back, which is good. I'd love to, but it's very much in the sense of I am want to be a working wrestler, but like I'll get myself a bit more attention with the still doing the wrestling gimmick, and hopefully that catches Disco's eye, which would be good.
I thought you were, because that's still doing the wrestling stuff seems to that would just fit in perfectly for Disco's kind of insidery hybrid crowd that they have, where like they know everyone, but at the same time they know it's a show, which is a lovely kind of crowd, which is like you can come out and they'll take to the still doing the wrestling stuff perfectly. So Alan, if you're listening, book Grant McIvor. I will vouch for him as someone who's watched wrestling long enough. That's it. I mean, it won't mean much, but I still vouch for Grant McIvor. Right, back to Source for a moment, because I did mention that you unfortunately lost the Source Wrestling Championship after, was it over 1,000 days?
I think it was just over 800. Well, 843,
Round it up. Round it up to 1,000.
Yes.
And so you lost it to Dalen Hendry, someone who's, of course, worked hard in Source Wrestling. I've heard amazing things about the match itself. I haven't had a chance to see it. I don't know if it's went up on YouTube as yet. But what was it like finally having to relinquish your Source Wrestling Championship, even having that length of reign, but not having the reign you probably wanted because of COVID reasons?
Well, my room looked a bit different with the title missing, which is a bit weird. I'd love to have held that title for 800 days with constant wrestling matches happening. So it was a very good place to be on a wrestling show as a champion, because you're looked to as having to be the best wrestler, having put on the best matches. Also, it just happened the way it turned out to be. It was very much a sense of I've had it for way too long, unfortunately, because of the dead period. But essentially, it was a bit of wanted to have a different story being told. Like, you never know what the wrestling match is going to go forward with. You want to be able to I'm just trying for the words for it.
Feel the emotion of losing the title. That's it. It's just
honestly, like, you never want to lose a title, which is a bit of a downer. But Dalen's a guy that was constantly, since training came back, Dalen was constantly working and try and get himself into the best shape and start to put on like good matches within training, and then finally had good matches on shows to the point he was given that opportunity. And like Dalen's been on shows longer than I have. I think he's kind of started a wee parts, a few parts. Obviously, he's married now. He's got a kid with him, with his missus. So it was like that kind of part that obviously took a bit of his attention away from wrestling. So he was able to come back, and once he was able to come back, he was a lot more focused and a lot more determined to become a big part of the shows. And I was happy that he was able to kind of transcend that and win his first title. Unfortunately, he's had to drop it through injury. A new champion was crowned last week, but hopefully he recovers well and he comes back and he can have his title rematch. I'm very much happy to be working on the shows as the guy who fights the big name that comes in. I fought Ian Skinner quite recently. I always wanted to be that guy who's the essentially the Undertaker, the guy who's like, you want to come in, you have to come through me kind of deal. So I'm very much happy to be just that strong part of Source Wrestling. A lot of people can fight amongst that title. I'm the man of the match of the night, and I know that.
I loved the build up between for your match with Ian. I was already kind of buzzing that month anyway because I was going to like Aberdeen Anarchy, and I'm always like jazzed for that kind of thing. But then I thought, oh, it's going to be the best match of the month. It's going to be amazing. And I saw you and Ian Skinner was announced. I was like, oh no. This could scupper my initial thoughts of match of the month coming in, because it was just the characters that you both had still doing the wrestling, and just whatever Ian decides to do that particular day is always a chaotic match made. And I don't know if it's heaven, I don't know if that's the word to use, but it's definitely a match of some description. So how much fun was it just I don't know, picking apart the meme lord himself and Ian Skinner?
We were kind of looking forward to that match as well, and just leaving the kind of sense of what we can do video-wise or promotional video-wise, because we're very much on that spectrum of pop culture, meme culture, shitposting kind of aspect of it. So we're very much kind of having a bit of fun building up to that. Match itself was a first cast time I've did a stellar match in that kind of sense with Skinner. He was a lot more, obviously I made the joke that he loves strong style, so it was very much my first time doing that kind of match. It was a kind of left a bit of marks on me, but I bruised like a peach anyway, so it's very much I'd love to be able to like maybe go to Japan and wrestle for like a month or two to an extent. So, and he's very much in that kind of mind frame. He wants to like be there as well. Like, I think he is wanting to try and get into Noah as they're looking for people. So it's just that adding a different kind of fella to my cap. I've wrestled that kind of match. I've wrestled to also want to be that kind of Swiss Army knife of a wrestler that can just wrestle with anybody. So it was different, but it was a great experience. I kind of hope to do it again.
I don't know if I can't remember if it was during that back and forth that there was some slander on a wonderful drink that I've been drinking throughout the episode, and Dr. Pepper. I think there was some Dr. Pepper slander that I did not appreciate during the build up, because it is a wonderful drink. I don't know. I can't remember what side you were on the argument.
Yep. Was a Pepsi Max. I was on the side of it. We met halfway in the middle at the end of the match with a nice Coke vanilla. So,
okay, right. I'm back on board. I'll do like a Coke vanilla. That's a nice choice. That's my meal. That's if it's not Red Bull sugar free, Coke vanilla is my meal deal choice, a drink of choice. Just a nice little sweetener for the end of a meaty sandwich, so to speak. Nobody cut that. Right, so back to some of the questions we've got here, and then we'll kind of wrap up your what's happened, what's your in-ring schedule at the moment. like I said, I'm not keeping you for the 2 hours that we did last time because we're both a bit tired. We're both a bit sleepy as it is. We've got Eddie Castle asking, Eddie Guerrero or Jeff Hardy?
Eddie.
Some C. An Eddie, two Eddie. Where's three Eddie? Where's Eddie number three? I lost the place.
No, there's a lowrider one coming, isn't there?
Yes, that's on my wish list. It's on WWE shop just now, or Euroshop. So it's on my list. It's waiting just for the right time to get it.
That's it. I mean, I might just
get it today.
IGWP championship win, pre-order the Eddie Guerrero.
Yes,
yeah. Lowrider. There you go. That's the champion's win first. I can't remember. Did we discuss about that Eddie Guerrero figure that you've unboxed? Have you ever been able to get a boxed edition of?
Oh no! Part of me is almost in the sense of, did I just take away? Because I think it's about £300 was one I saw.
Wow!
That was down the box, but I think you can see on the other side here. We've then got a second. How do I establish? That one there is I'm Your Pappy. And then that one there is just classic Latino Heat with the roses.
I'll do a bit of a collection. Mine's not as fast now because they're all over there behind the screen, which a little bit of a shame. And I just got the belts on. I can't do it either. Stop. They're all over there. Why do I keep going like that? They're there. That's my collection. Although I was looking at our last chat and I literally had a wardrobe behind me, and yeah, that was it. And I was like all hunched over trying to speak to you because I think I had my laptop at the time, so it wasn't this I would like to say it's a snazzier system, but I just got less scared to use my work PC for this recording shenanigans because it works. Laptop just likes to die at points. So other than the lowrider Eddie Guerrero, anything else on your kind of wish list of memorabilia, or is it just too long at this point?
Well, it's going to have to be an eBay buy now, and I think it's about $100 now. The Cruiserweight Eddie, like classic WCW 1995 Cruiserweight Eddie with the singlet, which I think that comes with the Cruiserweight title, but that's okay. I just want to get a wee kind of Eddie collection and essentially like keep it boxed, because as long as I don't plan to keep it forever, and there will probably be some bigger Eddie Guerrero fan than me that will see that and just like, yep, here's a grand, take it, I'll take it off you.
That's the hope.
Because I have this one in a box, but I'll just have it. This as well, because it came with a WrestleMania 20 pin, and I kind of wanted to use the pin.
That's fair.
It was like... I will pay an extra. I'll pay £10 extra for another pin.
Right. I used to have those pins. I don't know if it's the same kind, but I used to have WrestleMania 20. It came out with a pin set. Where is it? Must be at my parents' house in their loft. But it came with a pin set, so I've got pins from WrestleMania 1 to 20 somewhere. Nice. So I'll have to find them at some point, because surely someone will want to take them off my hands for an exchange of money. I'm sure. Jeff Hardy, I've got, I don't know if you remember, they came out with a mirror around about the time the Hardys came back, and it's got Matt and Jeff on it, and their faces are like profiles either side, and it's got the symbol in the middle, and it's like a one of, I don't know, 500. I think I've got one of them in my loft somewhere, because I'm just that in a doormat, a Hardy Boys doormat. I may have too much Hardy Boys memorabilia. I'm not surprised my wife's not allowed me to take any of those boxes home, because it's just this is what this room would turn into. All the Hardy stuff. I don't know where I was going with that, any of that. I just looked at your memorabilia. I was like, I want to ask about that. I want to ask about all of that. Eddie Guerrero. That's what we're talking about. Eddie Guerrero, Jeff Hardy. So obviously it's Eddie in your opinion. We Talk Show. I've asked King Kong or Godzilla.
Godzilla. Godzilla. 1998 Roland Emmerich's classic Godzilla.
I thought you were about just to turn around there and bring out like a mold, a die cast Godzilla there, to go with it, a little Jamiroquai at the bottom. We've got Major Matt Wolf asking a lot of little Andors in this question set. Land or sea?
That's the one again. I think you got off.
Oh, land or sea?
Land. I've watched a few documentaries on sea, and it's just absolutely terrifying.
Yeah, it's like when people get attacked by sharks, and it's like, yeah. No, you're in the wrong place. No,
not even just that. It's like I went through a very long period of just being obsessed with the Titanic wreck, and just understanding how it went down. Just the discovery of everything around the wreck, and you're just like, that's a good, you know, 1,000 miles under sea now, I think. But it was one thing one as well, just like TikToks of, and I have friends that have worked on oil rigs, but you just see somebody walking out of an oil rig at night, and they just look out into the complete absolute abyss of darkness. And you're just like, that is terrifying, like this pitch black. Like, if I fell in there, nobody would see me. And I was like, yep. Because I think, I don't know how much of the ocean is still undiscovered, but yeah.
Yeah, I'm quite happy with land.
Fear Cthulhu.
It's weird. Anyone says shark infested waters. No, that's where they live. If you're in there, then it's human infested waters. Just
yes.
Just no. Yeah. I'll stay on land. Preferably grass. I don't like sand either. Sand can go away.
You get in the cage, sharks in the water. Cage goes in the water.
He's also, I don't know if Major Matt, because we had a chat with Sharky Fossil earlier in the week, Wednesday. I don't know if he's tried to, these are questions for him, and he's thought, ah, fuck it, I'll just go for the next guy. It's Grant, here we go. He's also asked, favourite mythical being? I mean, is Godzilla a mythical being?
We'll have a look at the memorabilia wall just in case there's anything there. We've got... Minotaur. Minotaur's a good one.
Nice choice.
Oh, Hydra. Nah, the Hydra. Always love the Hydra when watching Hercules.
Back to the Eddie Guerrero chat for a moment. Is it very heartwarming seeing his son wrestle in WWE with his adopted father? Or no, his father, whom adopted him.
He does a lot more of any stuff than he does race stuff now. I always find that funny, because it's just one. Rey Mysterio was so fortunate he wears a mask during that period, because obviously you've seen him without the mask in WCW as part of Filthy Animals, and you're just like, at Dominic as a 10-year-old, you're like, no, you're him. You're not even his son, you're him. You're a younger version of him. So I think now he doesn't look too much like his dad, as he's kind of grown up, but you can still see it. Obviously folk joke that he looks like Bolter now. As a big Eddie Guerrero fan, I popped at a lot of Eddie stuff that he was doing during his WrestleMania match. I loved the entrance gear, the wrestling gear they wore. The
Los Gringos,
like
gear,
the Arbor, Los Gringos. Yeah, he pulled out the arm drag head scissors on that show. Just one of those, like, you know, I've always wanted to do that. I always loved when Eddie did that in the Los Guerrero's matches. And I'm just like, Bard, I was able to do an multi-man match. I was just like, you know, I'll be able to do it. I was able to held onto the cage for a bit just to make sure I was balancing all right in the top rope. But I got to have that, and that's a big Eddie move that I've always wanted to do, which is very happy about. But I was like, finally seeing him do it on WrestleMania, I was like if he's doing it, I'm going to finally do it.
Yeah, there were a lot of jokes going about when he did that. It was like, oh, your father will be proud, Dominic. I love that, like, talk about long-term storytelling, all that kind of stuff, maybe being lost, a lost art, but the fact that we possible nerds have called back a time in 2004 or 5 that Eddie Guerrero was Dominic's son, and now we're just not letting it go. We're just going, no, That's canon. We're keeping it. That's we're having that one. It's weird though that you see the new because you're a big you like you're collecting the build a figure in the latest set is Dominic Mysterio from when he was like 10.
But I don't know if I'll end up getting it. I like the Randy Orton one from like his summer slam title win, but I've never been one of the guys to get a full collection of a series to get the build a character in it. I very much just go, I'll buy what I like. And sometimes I even don't do that. I think I need to get the Edge in his white gear. I don't know. But it's probably like, I don't want to become too much of a man child.
I know, I'm in that kind of position now. Seeing as I'm going to be like a dad at the end of August, I'm like, okay. I see all these people. Thank you very much. That's why I'm finishing the podcast in July. But I keep looking at all the stuff I want to buy. I was in the Smiths and I saw there was the glow in the dark Undertaker pop was only £7. I was like, oh, I want it, but I'm gonna have a child soon. I can't buy it. And I went into the figure section.
This is the point you buy plush stuff to convince your wife it's for her, it's for the kid.
WWE, plush stuff. Come on. Give us more plush stuff.
Why have you bought all the 4 starter Pokemon? And it's like, it's for the kid. Look at the plush and soft. They'll sit next to him. And then you just play with them until the kid arrives.
I mean, saying that, I've got a 3-foot Hulk Hogan plush that is currently in my parents' house that we found in a charity shop. It's huge. Yeah. It's like, I did hand movements, but it's not really helping with the old camera thing. Yeah. But it's a good size. It gave me the creeps. It's by up to my knee. Yeah. And when I was moving out of my flat, I left it in the corner, thinking that's fine. I'll put it to my folks. Got up in the middle of the night, went through to the living room, absolutely shat my pants when I saw it because I was like, oh my god, there's someone in my house. Oh no, it's Hulk Hogan.
It's a funny one. So like my 3-year-old nephew, I think he was given Taz from the new Space Jam. It's like, I think my dad must have won it for him in a like grab machine at the theme park, and it just like kind of sits in this wee kind of chair, and he wakes up and like it's terrified of it because it just like, unless you know what the Tasmanian Devil is, it's not. I think it'll look very scary and intimidating for a 3-year-old. Did you see the gnarly teeth in the middle of the night? So it was like my dad was like, you can just have it. Just take it because it's
and you're like, oh no, my hands are behind my back here. I'll take it. Right, so we'll finish up your wrestling story, and then we have some more wild questions and whatnot. Is with Bard, we didn't really speak about it. You spoke a little bit. You got to do the Guerrero Huracanrana arm drag maneuver, but how did you find working in a cage in front of a crowd for ICW Bard in a big, I think it was the main event, wasn't it, as well? So
yeah.
It was Manifesto versus Team ICW. Big match. What were your thoughts and feels during and after?
Generally, amazing. Like, there was a nerve beforehand, especially because it's like the Super Smoking Thunderbolt match, which is essentially ICW's own play on the War Games. So we're very much in the sense of we're doing this match for the very first time. It's up to us to make sure that people want to see this match again, because I very much would like ICW to be able to run that match again, make it a part of a staple where people are like excited to see who would be in it this year coming. So it was very much in the sense of we need to make sure that this match itself, the stipulation, is amazing. Also big nerves. Like going ahead for it, it's the first time I've done a steel cage match in any regard, especially in front of a crowd. Decided to go a bit more extreme with the character, decided to don face paint, the dark eyes. I've decided to take a bit of a Wes Boland inspiration into the manifesto. We've always had that 90s grunge aspect to it, and I'm trying to, as we're going on, develop a bit more new metal aspect to it. But and also we went out into the match, just went, screw it, give everything, go absolutely tonto, do stuff that I've always been too afraid to do. And like even like coming back, people were kind of going like, that was absolutely amazing. Just when the first one, the 1 minute you went out, we just like 100 miles per hour. So it was absolutely brilliant. the match itself at the very end, obviously we took the loss, but that crowd was hot for at least 10 minutes afterwards. They were absolutely buzzing from Team ICW. They were still shouting abuse at us when we were lying down in the cage. It just felt like a big return to a garage ICW show. For the guy at ICW shows that were attracting the attention of BBC for the way to come and see Dog Menace. I felt like I was actually part of the ICW shows that I used to go to, instead of just being like, oh, I'm in an ICW show, I'm trying to get myself out of there. And it was being part of the main event. The very first like ICW big proper main event in the garage in a show like that. It just felt amazing. I just felt like I was on the top of wrestling world. And it was just, it's a match I've kind of sat and watched back at least twice now already. Just, I'm absolutely proud of that match. It's one of my matches I'm proud of the most, which was very good. And I think it was just one of the ones that I needed that. Mm-hmm. I needed to have a match of that kind of standard, of that kind of buzz, because it's just one of the ones that I'm very much to go. That's one of my favourite matches.
And I kind of believe you right at the start. It was kind of one of the times where you're like, yeah, that's, I'm back. I'm Grant McIvor again. I've got everything that I wanted back mm-hmm. and more.
One of the ones you can just, I just went back after the match and just went, that was what we wanted. Oh, that was even better than what we wanted, which is good.
So into the future, then we've got loads of stuff. You got your Iron Girder stuff, which we discussed. You got your Pro 2.
I'm Pro 2, isn't it?
Which, you know, I'm very excited to find out who is Pro 2. I've never been asked myself if I'm Pro 2, so maybe one day we'll have Logan will message me. So you've got the stuff at ICW, of course, which is available every week, most weeks anyway, on Saturday on the WWE Network. So if people want to go check that out, they can do. We've got a couple more fancy questions, so to speak. Last time we chatted, I only had one silly question, which was the dinosaur one, which I'm fairly certain you answered at the time. No, I know you didn't, because I didn't ask it. I don't think I asked it. I think you may have pulled me up afterwards saying that I didn't ask the question, I think. So I don't know if it's changed since we spoke way back when, but what is your favourite dinosaur?
Velociraptor.
Right. You may have answered that already. If still Velociraptor, that's fine, still constant. Yeah. I'm not going to...
Small, mobile, lethal. That's what I like.
Right. And we've added since then a question you may have heard if you've been in a locker room with Craiger and Looking Sharp at any point. What would win the fight? Two sheep or one cow?
Two sheep. No, one cow. Just needs to fall.
I was on board with you, because I'm still in the two sheep camp, and then you just ripped it away and under from under me. So no, you're wrong, but okay, that's your opinion at the end of the day.
All I can need to do is fall on top of one of them, and that's it. Do you know how much a cow weighs?
It was a terrible joke that I was about to say that.
I was like, is there a punchline to that?
I know.
I was looking myself. That's the dad genes coming into you now.
I know, I was about to say, I'll ask my ex-mother-in-law, I'll see how much she weighs. Crazy. I'm not having a good run. I think last week I called my mum fat on a recording, saying that I've got my mum's jeans and I'm fat. I thought, no, this is not going well. I'm now called, calling people cows. Ah, well, she was a cow. Anyway, right. Last question we asked is, like I say, fancy picking, is Vince McMahon phones you. He's went, Grant, my first name, of course, because it's Vince McMahon. We're booking you for the main event in WrestleMania. I've seen you wrestle. I saw you do the thing at Bar 2 with the maneuver, and I want you in the main event. And I'm going to let you book your opponent or opponents, the match, the stipulation, everything. My only request, because the Saudis won't allow it, they have to be alive. So, who is your fantasy opponent, main event at WrestleMania? What's the stipulation?
So Daniel Bryan, singles match, just traditional, bring on match.
Nice.
Yeah, that will somehow interject myself into a triple threat tag team TLC match.
I mean, you're in charge here. You can. Who's your partner in that in that case then?
Oh, we'll go Eddie. Keep it nice and local. Eddie, me and Eddie. Because that's on my list. I'll want to wrestle a triple threat tag team TLC match or ladder match. Because that was the first big match I ever got to see. Like the very first kind of over the top wrestling style match. So that's a big lock in my heart there. But traditional wrestling match would be traditional wrestling match with Daniel Bryan. Because I've gotten to become a big just wrestling technical geek.
Well, I'm surprised. I mean, obviously, the triple threat will probably have Christian in there somewhere, but I'm surprised it wasn't just you straight up against Christian somewhere in that. But, you know, it's your choice. Vince McMahon's going to abide by that, which is he's going to pay Tony a bunch of money to loan Daniel Bryan out for an even as well. Right. So I think we've covered everything in the last year or so. We've covered kind of things you want to do in the future. Of course, you want to work in Japan at some point. But is there any promotions out there in the next 12 months you want to try and get to any opponents the next 12 months? You're like, yeah, I think I could work some magic with them. Because I'm seeing Scotty Tuohy's coming regularly now. Eric Young as well is coming to the UK quite regularly. Is there anyone out there that you're like, get me in the ring with them?
I would love to wrestle Demo. Just like I have the old, he was my first coach. He trained me for the first 2.5 years. I have pals at this same age as me and same kind of experience of me that have had their matches with him, and I never got my match with my coach, so I'd very much like to have that match.
Well, perfect. That's a nice way to round out our catch up interview. We probably could go into tangents and be here for a very long time, but it's probably best that we don't for both of our mental sakes. But it's been a wonderful catch up, and hopefully when the podcast returns, if it does, then we'll get a part three in. I don't know what we have to be. Just bring it. It'll have to be Grant McIvor 3. Just bring it. That's the only logical way that these interviews can go. But so if anyone wants to find out more about Grant McIvor, the manifesto, or anything else you want to plug, where can they find it?
You can find me at the one Grant McIvor on both Instagram and Twitter. I think it's the same with TikTok. I'm starting to get a wee bit more on TikTok. I'm just doing the kind of daft promotional videos, but on that. And you can also find you can probably find the rest of the manifesto tagged in one of my Instagram posts or Twitter posts as well.
Excellent. Well, wonderful. Thank you very much for joining me again.
Thanks very much, bud. Enjoyed it.